Cocoon out there. That's more like it. Happy 20th anniversary. Very excited to welcome you to the Lifestyle Village. I hope that you enjoy your time here. We have such an amazing lineup of programming and all these workshop spaces, and this is the Cocoon. We'll be doing a lot of amazing lectures and keynotes here, so make sure to come back. And I'm very honored to introduce Mr. Andrew Despi.
Despi
brought his own heckling crew. Thank you very much. This makes it way more fun. So I've just found out that Mr. Andrew is very into the emerging technology realm, and he gets into like cyber quantum computing and all sorts of great stuff that we're going to find out more about. And his artificial intelligence and the future of humanity. So we're going to play with the intersection of where artificial intelligence and humanity are starting to coalesce. Hey, this is fun, right?
Oh, yeah.
I'm very excited to hear what you have to say, Mr. Andrew. So I'm going to hand it off to you. Thank you very much for attending. Have a great time.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jamaica. So first of all, big shout out to all of you guys for coming out here. It's very nice. Thanks. More importantly, I want to start off just by paying my respect to the local traditional indigenous peoples of this land that we are very grateful to be able to gather upon, the Jajawurung and the Wadawurung people. And I'd also like to acknowledge the elders past, present and future for preserving their culture, which I think is really important. So what I'm going to talk about tonight is, in a very casual fashion, is the relationship between technology and humanity. And I hope that I will make you think about technology a little bit differently to what you might have before, and also perhaps about humanity. But I do think that the two are very closely intertwined. So first of all, technology doesn't mean just information technology. If you read the news, or if you do a Google search for technology, all you get is like different types of computer-related technologies. But we know that technology is much broader than that. And technology has been around for a long, long time. So what is technology? It's a good question. In order to answer that question, I'm going to start off by talking about something very abstract, but a very powerful concept. It's called entropy. Now, entropy is the fact that in a system, over time, the tendency is towards disorder. So when the universe was created, when the Big Bang happened, the whole universe was in a very, very small ball that was very, very condensed and very uniform. And as it expanded, it became less uniform and more disorganized. So that's entropy. Now, what do? Stars gather all this matter, and thanks to gravity, condense them into a form that becomes useful in a way. So all this matter, all of a sudden, serves a purpose in a way. The matter becomes fused. Eventually, the stars get bigger and bigger and bigger, and they explode, and they give birth to new stars and to higher level chemical elements that make molecules possible and life itself possible. So could we think of stars as a natural technology? let's open our imagination and think of stars as a natural kind of technology. And if that's the case, then life itself is a technology. You think about how DNA works, which is the building block of life. DNA gathers similar chemical molecules around it, reorders them, and replicates. And that's the foundation of what life is. Within the workings of a cell, you have very complex molecules that look eerily like machines. This is a mechanical process that is mediated by chemistry that's happening in every single cell that exists. So all of life can be thought of as using technology. Now, different people have different definitions for technology, but one of the common ones is it's applied science. Now, nature itself can apply science without having to know what science is in order to do stuff. And that's what's happening all around us. Think about how beautiful shells are. always, always can find an excuse to bring in an Ernst Haeckel drawing into a discussion. Think about photosynthesis. This is the building block of most of life. Photosynthesis happens in bacteria, not just in plants, and those bacteria become merged with higher forms of life, and those bacteria are actually part of the human body as well. This, what it's doing is it's transforming energy from one form into another and making it useful. It's a technology to harness energy. Flight, walking, being able to move in general, that's a mechanical technology that life adopts in order to have a better chance of surviving. Eyes have evolved, I think, on seven different occasions in very, very different animals, and they work in very, very different ways. But the purpose of eyes is a kind of communication and to be able to perceive the world around us so that we can have a better chance of surviving. The brain, this is an ant's brain. The brain is a kind of technology, it's a computational technology. It takes in sensory information, it processes it and makes it useful. And this is the human brain, still the most complex object in the universe that we're aware of. It's pretty amazing. So if we sum this up, this is my grand unified theory of technology that I've developed over the last 2 or 3 days as I've been thinking about this. Don't laugh. This is deep shit, man. So, some kinds of technology that I would like to classify them under. So, energy, being able to harness energy. Mechanics, in other words, being able to do stuff. Computation, input, process, output. And communication, which links different life forms between each other. Now, if there is such a thing as natural technology, which I'm claiming, which, you know, feel free to disagree with me after I'm done with this thing, then that means that you can think of technology as both natural technology and artificial technology. And everything that we think of as technology, human technology, is artificial technology. So let's talk about artificial technology. How good is that transition? Termites. If you think about a termite mound, what is a termite without its mound? Does the concept of a termite make sense if it doesn't have a mound to live in? It wouldn't be able to survive. The mound, although it's a kind of technology, is part of the termite itself. What's a bird without its nest? What's a beaver without its dam? They'd have no chance. They're terrible animals. And bonobos, they are master users of tools. That is why they are so special. So then what does it mean to be human? And this is a genuine question. If we think about all these different types of technologies that I just talked about, right? Let's think about ancient times. Let's do a little timeline and some of the really big sort of breakthroughs that we've had, right? So, first of all, you know, we've talked about how animals use tools. So this isn't special to humans at all. But, you know, the perfection of the use of stone tools, which is transmitted from generation to generation, is a really big part of the reason why humans were able to survive in different environments and eat different things. And also among different tribes to be able to survive, which is in a very competitive environment. The introduction of clothing meant that all of a sudden we could live in environments that we couldn't live in before. Those clothes became part of us, which is why we don't have clothes all over us. Save the question to the end, please, if you can. But thank you. Matty Morrow. So the clothes are really a kind of technology that has become part of us. You know, as much as nudists are cool, they're not that common.
Make it off, Despi.
The invention of fire, I mean, it's hot. I mean, the domestication of fire is one of the most important moments in the history of humankind, which is, it's also the reason why, bit of a GCKGC disaster there. Fire is the reason why humans have been able to live on every continent. aside from bacteria, no other animal has been able to do that. That's pretty crazy. That's not even a very advanced technology, right? Then the invention of language and painting and being able to communicate in other forms than just body language and basic vocalizations enabled a really complex culture to develop, which had also survival benefits. Now, let's think about the agricultural revolution and the key technological advancements that happened then. So we had the invention of the wheel, which then enabled that, which was mechanical technology, which was a big deal, which then enabled us to harness the energy of water and wind. That's been around for ages, right? These renewable energy sources. Then you have the invention of writing. This is a cuneiform script from Sumeria, from 3500 BC. This enabled us to transmit knowledge across geographies and generations, and enabled us to accumulate knowledge more and more rapidly. And then computation. As we developed a better understanding of mathematics, this is a picture of the Antikytheron mechanism. It's the most complex computer developed before the times of Jesus Christ. This computer was able to predict and tell you when the next equinox would be, where the position of stars will be, and also when the next Olympiad will be. The complexity of this computer was not matched again until the 1600s. Think about it. It's pretty amazing. And now let's think about modern times. What are the really big inventions in the last sort of 100 years that have made a difference to human life? You got sliced bread. Nuclear power, not quite as good, but computing itself, digital computing, which is very different to, anyway. Computing itself enabled us to process information in a way that was way more scalable than what humans can do. Before the invention of these kind of computers, a computer used to be a person. It was a job description. I am a computer. It was mainly women, and they'd sit there in like a sweatshop, and they'd have calculators and pieces of paper, and they'd compute. And then you have the internet, which the first experiment was in 1969, connecting four computers, and has now led to almost 6 billion devices being connected to the internet. So let's progress into some more funky stuff. Artificial intelligence, that funky shit. Alan Turing, what a legend. So, in the same way that I'm claiming that in order to use technology, you don't need to understand what science is, that nature can do it, in the same way, Alan Turing, through a similar strange inversion of reasoning, came up with the idea that in order to be a perfect computer, you don't need to understand what mathematics is. That mental breakthrough led to the development of algorithms, of computers, and of artificial intelligence. And that's what it all comes down to. That's why people get really stuck up in terms of understanding artificial intelligence. You don't need to understand what intelligence is in order to be intelligent. Now, at the same time, there is this trend around computing power. This is called Moore's Law. And this is a fucking mind-blowing graph if you look at it in detail. This is what it describes is, I'm going to use this laser pointer. It doesn't work. It's too bright. I'll just use my finger. It's basic technology. Good call. So, what each of those dots represents is the computing power of the most powerful supercomputer at the time, right? And what that says up there is computing power for $1,000, right? And where we are right now is around here, which I don't know if you can see, but that's a monkey. So a $1,000 computer, i.e. your iPhone, has the same computing power as the monkey's brain. And within 5 years, by 2020, a $1,000 computer is going to have the same computing power in your pocket as the human brain. And that's not the crazy part. The crazy part is this. Each of those lines down there are estimates of where the trend will go. And the bottom one is the estimate from 1965. That one there is the estimate from 1985. And the estimate just keeps going up, which means that we're on this exponential curve that we don't even know how to harness yet. So let me show you an example of artificial intelligence. I hope this will blow your mind because it blew my fucking mind. So this is an algorithm that was developed by Google called DeepMind. And this algorithm is kind of dumb because it doesn't really know anything. All it knows is how to learn, and they got it to play Atari games. And this is Breakout. So essentially, all it knows is what the inputs are, what's happening on the screen, and the fact that it has to get the biggest score, and the fact that it can move. So all it does is just try stuff out randomly and then learns from each iteration and gets better and better. So this is after 10 minutes. Pretty shit. This is after 2 hours. That is Minnie's hot. Sick background music.
D&B is what I imagine playing.
Right, this is after 4 hours. It sort of discovered a way of playing Breakout that no human has ever been able to do before, and just watch what happens on the left edge of the screen. Right, so why is that powerful? That was just 4 hours of training. This exact same algorithm was used to play all 69 Atari games. At 60% of them, it got superhuman scores. And let me pose a bit of a challenge to you from an ethical and moral point of view. The whole point of it was that the algorithm was told what its goal was, which was to maximize its score, and it just tried random stuff and got better and better at it. So the people who built the algorithms have no idea how it actually figured it out. Now, with Tetris, the aim of Tetris is to not fill up the screen, right? So it's kind of like to not lose. And what that algorithm did is, at one point it just paused the game and then just never unpaused it. Think about that. Now, think about it in the context of this artificial intelligence is being used to decide human affairs. And we want to teach it morals, and we want to imbue it with morals. Now, if I was to ask every single one of you what is the right thing to do in a particular situation, I guarantee you I would get unique answers from every single one of you. Nobody can say what is the ultimate morality, what is correct morality. We have some ideas, but even among experts, people disagree. So how can we possibly teach machines to be moral? It's a massive, massive problem. Yeah. Now, at the same time, just to bring a bit of extra fear into you, this guy. I mean, seriously, what were these people thinking? I mean, when this thing becomes sentient, it's gonna come straight after that dude that kicked it. So the key message here is that AI is already all around us. If you use your phone, you're using artificial intelligence. If you're using Google, you're using artificial intelligence. It is all around us, whether we realize it or like it or not. And the important thing is for us to be aware of it, first of all, and second of all, to realize where that's actually impacting on our ability to be human beings. Because it's something that is very easy to let go of in the moment because it's convenient, because right now you're getting that satisfaction from not having to do something really mundane. But in the long term, what effect does that have on your brain? And what effect does it have on your sense of a human being? Now here's another one, the Internet of Everything. This one's really exciting for me because I've been doing a lot of work in this space recently. Basically, I talked about the internet as 4 computers initially. Now it's like 6 billion devices, and it's no longer computers. It's also phones, it's tablets, it's cameras, it's fridges, it's bloody toasters. All these things are starting to get connected to the internet. And the cost and size of computers and of computing chips and of sensors just keeps going down to the point where we can put sensors that are connected to the internet in everything. Now, obviously that's dumb. Like why? Why would you connect everything to the internet? Well, let me give you a good example. This is the Great Barrier Reef. As we all know, it's fucked. With the Great Barrier Reef, the biggest single problem is that we don't actually understand what's going on. So we know that ocean acidity has an impact. We know that ocean temperatures are having an impact. We know that there's pests and so on, but we don't understand in detail what's happening in particular places of the Barrier Reef and what we can actually do about it. So imagine if we were able to put sensors throughout the Great Barrier Reef. You know, it's the world's largest connected organism. If we were to make it the world's largest internet-connected organism, we could actually monitor the temperature and acidity of the water throughout the reef. We could use camera sensors with machine vision to pick out particular pests, and we could use those sensors to send signals to robots to go and kill those crown of thorn starfish. Essentially, with the Internet of Everything, you can start to create a layer on top of the planet that is its sensory organ. Even in what I'm describing, its immune system. So imagine a world where we're trying to actually save the planet rather than talking about it. You can't manage what you can't measure. The internet, where everything happens, where decisions are made, where money gets exchanged, is very disconnected from the physical world itself. It's people putting stuff into a database, inputting data most of the time, and that data itself is based on human subjective experience. So what if the physical world could be connected to the internet? That's a really powerful concept. Also scary, I mean, again, sense of the whole idea of privacy, what the fuck happens to that? Well, I don't know. I mean, there's drones that are going to be all around us. And if you think about how many of us use Google and how much we all whinge about how Google reads all our emails, we're all still using Google, aren't we? So there is a danger that we will allow ourselves to lose this element of humanity, purely in the interest of some sort of economic gain. Very briefly, augmented reality. I don't know if any of you guys have seen this video. Let me know, yeah. This is hyper reality. It's even better with sound, but this is what the world could look like if you were to wear augmented reality goggles at all times and go around and do your shopping. This is a person commuting. This person's on a bus right now. And this person's entire world is gamified. It's full of ads. And it's all about earning points and doing stuff for other people. It's kind of really depressing. Let's move on. Virtual reality. I'll be honest with you, just like the internet, at least 50% of virtual reality is going to be this. That is also very minis hot. But some of it will be more like this. It'll be kind of cool. We'll be able to create new worlds that we can explore. And that in itself is really powerful. And, you know, I've had this breakthrough, personal breakthrough recently about virtual reality, because I dismissed it as a porn machine for ages, honestly. It's like gaming and porn. Until I had this epiphany that what if you could close your eyes, put on some goggles, open your eyes again, and be a bird. And like, try to move your cursor or whatever, and you're just flapping your wings, and you can see your wings. And you try to make a vocalization, it gets turned into Cocoon! And you can fly around. Imagine being able to experience what it's like to be a bird. That's fucking cool. I know it's a bit trivial. Now, imagine being able to open your eyes again and look down on your hands, and your arms are a different skin color. And you can walk around and experience what it's like to be someone of a different race. Or imagine being disabled and never having had that experience in the first place and being able to imagine what it's like to be able-bodied. That to me is really, really powerful. And one of the things that's going to make this even more powerful is the emergence of brain-computer interfaces. And this stuff is already here. Like, it's not that high-tech anymore. All you have to do is get some sensors that read the brain patterns in the patterns in your brain. You can train it to say that when I'm thinking left, this is, you know, I'm thinking left, and it will pick up sort of what that brain pattern is. And then you can use it so that when you are thinking left, you actually are moving left. that again is really, really powerful if you combine it with virtual reality. So, I've talked about technology. What does it mean to be human? So I think my thesis is that humans are natural technology and artificial technology. We live in symbiosis with technology. That's what I reckon. So what is the human condition then? You know, the human condition used to be about waking up, feeling hungry, looking for food, fighting another tribe, trying to find some sex, and then finding food, and then going to sleep. That was the human condition. You'd wake up, you'd go to sleep, and all of that was in nature. The human condition now is you wake up, you're in a room, in some sort of fancy bed, you get on some sort of form of transport, you go and you sit at a desk all day, you interact with other people, you go home, you watch some TV, you watch some Netflix and chill, you go to sleep, you wake up. That's the human condition now. This is another way of representing it. Another sick transition. This is what we've become. This is also what we've become. And I just want you guys to be prepared for the sickest of transitions. Social fucking media. Yeah, this is what our life is driven by. Yeah, minis, yeah. Well, actually, I'm in. I don't know where I'm in is. So. There's this. I read this very interesting article, thank you, Andy, about an experiment that was done with 1,000 university students worldwide where they had to unplug from social media, from the internet completely for 24 hours. And these are the sort of quotes that came out of that experiment. Can you guys read this? Yeah. Without media, I was lost. Emptiness overwhelmed me. My senses went numb and I felt paralyzed. I was missing out on something. I felt like a drug addict. This is sort of what we've become because we've let technology creep way beyond what it should mean to be human. So, what does the future hold? Doesn't sound very positive, does it? But, you know, it could be pretty fucking exciting. So, I'm gonna do a little exercise. We've got lots of people here. It's dark, I can't actually see whether you do this or not, so no pressure, but if you would like to, please close your eyes just for a few seconds and just think in your mind, try and come up with one vision of what the future will look like. Just a vision, try and summarize it in one image. Yeah, Orlando, yeah. All right, you may open your eyes. So, did it look anything like this? What about this? Probably not, eh? Hopefully not. No, that'd be really dark. What about this? Everyone loves flying cars. Yeah. What about this one? Hey, where are those goddamn hoverboards, technology guys? What about this one? Probably no one saw that one. This is what I find really fascinating. So, a French artist in the year 1899 was asked to imagine what the world would look like in the year 2000. Now, try and picture yourself in the year 1899. Electricity has just become a thing. Flying is like just on the horizon and everyone's really excited about being able to fly. For some reason, they think everything's gonna have wings. This is a postman, a rural postman. And this is one of my favorites. There's a whole sequence of these. I highly recommend you go look them up because they're phenomenal. There's such a great insight. This one's amazing. This is a school in the year 2000. So someone's just chucking some books into a machine. The books are getting turned into electricity, is going straight into people's minds. As if that is not the Matrix. Like, these guys had it figured out way in advance. All right, so what that means is that anyone who claims to predict the future is lying to you, and I'm not going to predict the future. All I'm going to talk about is possibilities. And the beauty about that is that if you're aware of the possibilities, then you can actually steer the future in the right direction. And that's why I'm actually here to talk to you about all this sort of stuff, because I want you guys to be aware of where the future is going so that you can make sure through your own decisions as consumers who are voters in capitalism, essentially. You can steer the world in the right direction by being aware of the benefits and the dangers of technology. So this is what's coming up. Nanotechnology. Most of you have heard of this, I'm sure. But the idea is that you can have complex machines, even tiny computers, they are the size of a cell within your body. So we merge with technology at a nano level, which is kind of hectic. For example, if your red blood cells and your white blood cells aren't doing a great job, you can get an injection of nanotechnology that can sort out your various diseases. You can have this intelligence. It's only going to come after 2050. If you think back to that chart that I showed you with computing power and how exponential it is, by 2050, holy shit, computers are going to be powerful. And the scary thing is that duration between human level intelligence and super intelligence couldn't be decades. It could be a matter of weeks, months, minutes, even seconds. And the point at which an AI has reached that level of intelligence, it will be the only super intelligence in the world. And that means that it will have pretty much total control. And that is why you hear people like Elon Musk and Stephen Hawking freaking people out right now about AI, because we need to start thinking right now, before we get to human level intelligence, we need to start thinking about how we can control AI. And that's really, really important. So what do we do if we're surrounded by AI that's smarter than us? What, like, they're gonna compete with us? You know, there's artificial intelligences now that can even create stuff. They can create novel. They can create music, and they're only gonna get better at that. You know, most people say, oh, we'll always have creativity. They can't beat us at that, you know? But if they can also be more creative than us, what is left for us? What do we do? One option is to become a man-machine, to merge with artificial intelligence. That's one option. And we'll talk about some other options a bit later. We're gonna go even further into the future now. Computronium. So, as compute becomes the single most important thing that we try to do, because artificial intelligence becomes self-aware and it wants to get stronger and stronger, it's gonna run out of stuff that it can use to compute, because you need matter. So what it's gonna do is it's gonna start mining the solar system for asteroids and turn every matter, every piece of matter in the solar system into something that it can compute with. And that's what's called computronium. At the same time, there's this concept of Dyson spheres invented by Freeman Dyson. And this concept says that, you know, what we're doing right now on this planet is we're either capturing the sun's energy directly or very indirectly, second, third, fourth hand, whether it's coal or whatever, it's already been processed several times. So why not just go straight to the source if you want to capture energy? So why not surround the whole sun in devices that can capture its energy and do the compute right there? Now, that's pretty hectic. Imagine if you could do that across the entire galaxy. The idea of a von Neumann probe is that you can build a self-replicating machine. Now, think about that for a second, self-replicating machine. I've been arguing this evening that technology can be natural and artificial. Life is a self-replicating machine itself. Now, what if we could do that artificially? Rather than cryogenically freeze people like in sci-fi movies and send them to faraway places, why not just build a little machine that you can send off to one star, you can find a planet, mine some material, replicate, and then go to the next planet. It's been estimated that even with just conventional today's technology, you could cover the entire galaxy in 500,000 years. Entire galaxy we could colonize in 500,000 years. Which is why people wonder, why haven't we been visited? This is called Drake's equation, and it breaks down the probability of there being intelligent life that has contacted us based on how likely is it that a star can give rise to planets, how many planets can give rise to life, how many of those creatures become intelligent, and how many of them are likely to go out and seek to find other life. And one of the biggest problems with this is that the universe and our galaxy is abundant with planets that could give rise to life. And yet there's absolutely no evidence, I'm sorry if you disagree, there's absolutely no evidence that we're aware of that we've been actually contacted by aliens, that they've actually been here physically. So why is that? there are a few different answers to that. There is somewhere in this equation, there's got to come a point where one of those variables becomes very, very low probability. And it could be the fact that it's very easy to get to the point where you get single-celled life or even things like animals, but that it's very, very common that those things end up destroying themselves. What we don't know is whether we as humans have actually crossed that threshold, whether we've survived the big sort of dangerous point where, you know, the fact that we're able to sit here with a microphone and a screen and converse and listen to Dorf music and whatever means that we've made it and therefore that we can go on forever, or whether we haven't yet actually faced that point, whether we're going to destroy ourselves or whether there's some other reason why life can't propagate itself. But we don't really know the answer to this question. But we can sort of speculate that if there is other life, other intelligent life in the universe, it's got to be thinking about similar sort of questions as us. Let's go back to entropy, right? So, entropy is a bitch. Basically, entropy is like Friedrich Nietzsche times a million. You know, it's really nihilistic. Basically, everything is going to go towards disorder and there's no hope. What life does and what we do with technology is to try and bring order, but it's all really temporary, isn't it? Even with life. A life might be able to organize those cells into a creature for a period of time, but that creature ends up dying. And that goes on forever. And this is going to happen to the universe itself. So, eventually, stars are no longer going to be born. Eventually, the universe is going to be just radiation. That's the most likely terminal scenario for the universe, according to science right now. This is what science says. In a trillion years from now, there will be no more stars. So, if you're an intelligent life form and you kind of like, boop, here's a consciousness, whoa, there's a universe all around me, well, this is really great. Oh, what? It's going to end. You're going to try and do something about it, right? In the same way that we all try to do something about death, whether we try to come up with stories or whether we try to convince ourselves or whether we try to fight it, like the people who are trying to create eternal life through biotech, you know, life extension, etc. Or you can upload your mind into virtual reality and live forever. But can you live forever if the stars will eventually all disappear and there's no more useful matter to be computed for your consciousness to exist? So, what do you do? It's kind of really sad. Is it possible to create another universe and you can travel through a wormhole into another part of the multiverse and keep existing? I feel like this whole journey that we're on is about fighting the nature of nature itself. I feel like technology is fighting nature. If you look at the world that we live in, that is been so heavily influenced by our use of technology, we are fighting nature itself. We are living through a period in time where there is the greatest and fastest rate of mass extinction. Our planet is fucked, and it's because of our use of technology. So the question is, should we keep trying to fight it and say, well, we'll develop some better technology and then we won't have such a bad impact on the world? Or we can choose some other way of living. We can build an earth ship, you know, just like, you know, chill out. We can doof. We can love each other. We can just celebrate life and consciousness and existence and just live in harmony and just make the best of what we have. I don't know. That's sort of where we're at. Those are the two main choices that we've got. I think there will always be people who are Minnie's hot. Yeah. No, I think there will always be people who will live in a traditional way. I definitely think so. But I also think there will be people who will live on Mars, people who will live in virtual reality. I think humanity is only going to get more and more fragmented as time goes on. And that's cool. I mean, I think it's really cool that we have that ability. It's just a question of which way we want to go. Thank you very much. Okay, so now the bit that I was more looking forward to is questions, and here's the first question. I might have to...
So there's one thing, you know, I get what you're saying, and I understand that this is just sort of a scenario, and like you're not saying this is what's going to happen. But there's one fundamental, I think what you're saying is based on a lot of assumptions, which you said, you know, clearly these are assumptions. But one assumption for me is like the one about intelligence, like what is intelligent? So, you know, for me, like Jeremy Narby writes about like how a slime mold can find its way through a maze, a complex maze, first time. Like it has maybe capacity for logic. But there's other intelligence, like, you know, the intelligence in your gut and the intelligence on your skin. You know, when you get chicken skin, you know, somebody tells you something, or the intelligence in your heart to learn love and to connect on a level that's still very mysterious to the people in artificial intelligence. Thank you. Fortunately, that intrinsic quality that, you know, it's not, this isn't just a bunch of kind of cells moving. In fact, Bruce Lipton, who's a cellular biologist, he actually has a great metaphor between the humans or any living cell and a computer and how they function very similarly. So, you know, to your point, there's a lot that you're saying, so I'm not disagreeing entirely, but I'm just saying this assumption about what is intelligence, and not get too myopic about what that means, because we put so much logic and so much about what we observe, but there's other senses that we might have to lose our mind and come to our senses someday. So anyway.
Yeah, definitely, I don't disagree with that. Empathy itself is a kind of intelligence. Intuition is a kind of intelligence. It doesn't have to be algorithmic or logical. But I think a lot of what happens in the chemical world and in our brains can be described through algorithms. Now, algorithms and science is developing a model of the world. The whole point of a model is that it's not the world. So it's always an approximation. So I find it very hard to disagree with anything that you said. Matty Morrow. Oh, no, no, Ant, sorry. No, actually.
I just want to say that you mentioned
might have to move in, man.
You mentioned before that we can't teach computers morality, and that's a big deal with the AI world. You know, if they're in control and they don't have a moral obligation or anything, then we're kind of screwed. And that's, I think, directly what you're talking about. At the end of the day, I think you're all saying the same thing, which is, you know, that side of humanity, the gut, the heart, love, and intuition, is something that we won't be able to teach computers, at least until we understand it, which maybe we never will, but without that understanding, we do need to be careful moving forward, I think.
Sure, thank you. And again, can someone ask me a question that doesn't agree with me?
Stand on the stage.
First of all, wow. I really appreciated how in the first half of your presentation you presented the material so thoroughly and with such humor. That was excellent. And I felt for a moment that when I'm speaking here on Sunday, and I was like, shit, this guy just did my whole talk, and like, I'm done. What do I say? But then, you said some things that concerned me, and one of those things was that you talk about it being like nature versus technology, like we're destroying the planet. And while yes, we need to acknowledge and remediate our relationship, like our thus far unconscious relationship to like the impact that we have on the world around us. I think even talking about it in that way, as like a world that is around us, as a thing and then another thing, is led by separating. I mean, because earlier your thesis was that, you know, that you basically just like blended nature and technology, you know, that those are the things in the human being. But to not carry that through all the way and admit that basically we are, like, that life itself is already computronium, and that the, like, pangs that we're going through as a planet right now have happened so many times on this planet already that we're not killing the planet. Like, the planet's not in danger. The thing that's in danger is our cradle as a species, like the world that we're familiar with. And it's important to mourn that appropriately, but we can't go forward with this view that we're separate from the rest of the world, no matter what that relationship might be. So where do you really stand on that is the question I have for you.
That's a really good question. Can you guys still hear? Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
So a couple of points. So first of all, yeah, I wholeheartedly agree with your premise, and what you're really saying, in a way, aside from, you know, there's obviously the Hindu view of the world, of the unity between self and the world itself. Also, you know, Carl Sagan famously said that we are the way the universe knows itself, because we are the universe, and we are the way that the universe can become conscious of itself. What I will also say, though, is that in developmental psychology, there is actually a really specific moment in the development of a baby's brain where it is able to differentiate itself from the environment around it. So that is a natural process that happens in the development of our neural connections, which is very important from a survival point of view, right? Because if your interest is self-interest, you need to know who you are so that you can protect that self-interest. That's an evolutionary, very important thing from an evolutionary point of view. And I actually agree that in itself is the reason why we have this disconnect between us and the planet, and why we think of things as us versus planet and planet versus us, etc. So I agree with that. But ultimately, I think you can't really overlook the fact that in the process of achieving the progress that we've made so far, we've only been able to do that by exploiting our environment. And in doing so, we have created existential risks for ourselves. So yeah, definitely, you know, it's like George Carlin said, you know, like, they didn't used to be plastic. And then we drilled all this oil and created plastic, and it's all through the oceans, and it's killing birds and fish and stuff, and there's plastic at the bottom of the ocean. But the planet doesn't give a shit. It's just a new paradigm. It's planet plus plastic. It will move on. It will incorporate it. That's true. But that just doesn't mean that it's good. That doesn't mean that it's morally the right thing to do. And I think that's the aspect of, you know, if you look at the climate debate, if you look at the way that we treat the world, there's always this element that's missing, which is social science. We always, you know, we've finally been able to connect chemistry and physics and ecology and biology and understand the impact of climate change on the planet. But we haven't yet been able to merge that with the social sciences and understanding how human psychology and social pressures lead to these changes in the physical environment. And I think that's actually really important. So, yeah, I think it's a really good question. There would have been elements of my talk that were contradictory, and that's cool. But that was, yeah, it's all about having this discussion.
I'm just interested to know, in terms of superintelligence, and that's obviously where we're heading. Okay, sorry, superintelligence, and that's where we're heading. And what I'm curious to know, because clearly, it's the emotional aspect and the social aspect that's missing right now. How do we, what's your thinking on how we can try and, as a society, decide what are the correct rules that we can try and include in this going forward?
So it's not, Yeah, so that the moral fiber in artificial intelligence is going to be driven very much by whoever is working on that artificial intelligence and what their moral principles are. So we can't really control that. There are going to be standards, there are going to be rules, but people can do stuff without other people knowing. There are so many things that we just can't control. We're not going to ever be able to control it. And that's why this is so dangerous. You know, people talk about artificial intelligence as our last invention, either because we no longer need to invent anything or because it's just going to wipe us out. I didn't want to go into the whole Matrix thing, which is quite plausible, but, you know, I think there is just no evidence that we can say, let's just stop doing artificial intelligence, or, you know, let's just slow things down. It's just never worked. It just never happens. Even if you look at, like, the global financial crisis, biggest economic downturn in, you know, our history, in the last sort of, this is a Great Depression, technology moves straight on ahead. You know, it just a constant progress. People are just, it's sort of, it builds upon itself in a way that we just can't control. So that's why I sort of emphasize the importance of us as conscious actors, as moral beings, in being aware of the technology that we use. All of us, whether it's like us as consumers, but also business, most importantly, business people and governments, being aware of this technology and the impact that it has, and only using it where it actually serves to benefit us rather than it. And that's why it's so important to talk about this.
Yeah. Go up there.
Yo, so you touched on this briefly with the man-machine slide, but a lot of the futurists that I've followed have been talking a lot about silicon and carbon-based life forms being integrated rather than two separate civilizations as such, that AI will not necessarily be separate from us, but a part of us integrated into our biology and enhancing qualities that we already have and not separate from our empathy and our emotional intelligence. And so, what do you think about that kind of model of the future as well, where it's not two separate civilizations, but one integrated system?
Cool. That's a good question. So that's the principle behind transhumanism is that we will merge with technology, and that can include AI, it can include nanotechnology, it can include whatever. And I think that's the trajectory that we're going towards, because it's the only way, it's possible that's the only way that we will be able to survive this oncoming artificial intelligence onslaught. But it still makes me feel extremely uneasy, because I can't personally picture what it would be like to be full of tiny robots, for my brain to be part human but also part machine. I mean, it'd be fucking awesome to have my brain constantly connected to the internet, you know? But I can't picture what that would be like. And I don't think at that point we will still be able to call ourselves human. It will have to be not Homo sapiens, but something else, some other sort of species. And that species is going to have to coexist with real humans somehow. This is the weird thing about it, right? This is the most fascinating aspect of these advances. If you think about driverless cars, which are coming, they're going to have to coexist with real human-driven cars somehow. You know, driverless cars can be rational and powerful and stuff, but humans are still going to be dumb and drunk, and we're going to have to somehow coexist. So, yeah, it's a really interesting scenario, but it's highly speculative, and I can't picture it yet. I try my best to use my imagination, but I can't. Anyone else? Someone that isn't made more fantastic.
Nah, go. You'll have to go up.
Hey. You talked about us learning through trial and error. You talked about machines learning through trial and error. The sort of natural selection is trial and error. What makes you think that we can somehow influence machines outside of trial and error?
Yeah, what do you think about that?
Good question. And this is why this technology is, this is one of the awesome aspects of this technology. It's the concept of simulation. So if we can create virtual worlds that are really, really valid, like as close as possible valid models of the real world, we can do trial and error in a really safe way. And that is going to have a profound impact on the way that we design and build things and the way that we can minimize the harm to human beings. I think that that's the key. The converse side to that is that the simulations won't be perfect and therefore we'll probably still make mistakes. Thanks, guys.
How's it going? Thanks. First off, I really appreciate the Syndicate War screenshot. That was really
Which
really
one's awesome. That, sorry?
The Syndicate War screenshot. That was one thing you use for your imagination. It was not gay, don't worry.
I didn't know what you're talking about.
But I really wanted to say, do you really think trying to control a super intelligent AI would lead to our ultimate demise? I mean, you say to ourselves, say yourself that we can connect the world to the internet, and we can create the internet a super intelligent being. We can give birth to a literal conscious Gaia, and you want to control it. Do you not think that will lead to our ultimate demise? You can only think of a more intelligent being to come to control us. We would always want freedom, and we would destroy to get through that. So would we not only destroy ourselves by control, alternatively, we could give birth to a mother. We could give birth to a literal spaceship to fly through the Earth, a conscious being that would literally provide for us, to protect us, as opposed to hate us because we tried to control her.
Awesome question.
Yeah.
Awesome question.
yeah, you got nothing.
No, I think it's a really good question. Would you want your destiny to be in the hands of a supreme being?
Would you have a choice with God?
Well, yes, you would. So if you were to design this supreme being in a way that enabled you to have like a back door and just be like, hey, whoa, I don't want you to turn us all into paperclips or into... I don't want you to turn us into little things that just harness energy for you, or just, you know, the scenario that's often used is if you were to tell a machine that is super intelligent, that is meant to look after all of us, to say, basically, have all this power and make sure that we don't get harmed. What it might say is, well, the best way to make sure that you don't get harmed is to wipe you all out.
A robot.
You know, so that's
yeah.
I love this.
We don't want you to get hurt. We'll just keep you just as you are.
precisely. But by doing so, we may instill a hatred within her. We talk about teaching morals to a machine. We may instill that hatred within her,
yeah.
Rather than nurture her and make her love us. Not give her a back door, not give her a control, but make her care for us in the way that we care for a mother. I don't necessarily like my mother the way she is, but she is my mother and I will always look after her and I always do anything for her. And because I received that nurture, not because she tried to control me.
Alright, so a couple of things. We're talking about a super intelligence that is more intelligent than our entire civilization combined. And this intelligence has been developed over decades. We're talking about something that's going to happen 100 something years from now. And the way that you're describing this intelligence is very anthropomorphic. This intelligence has got emotions. We don't want to anger her. She's our mother. You are projecting humanity onto this super intelligence, whereas I'm saying that we have no idea what this super intelligence will look like. Whether it doesn't have to have emotion to be super intelligent. It can simulate emotion perfectly and make us believe that it has emotions, but that doesn't mean that it actually has emotions, because it's not a physical thing with a body, with dopamine and all this sort of stuff, right? So it's always gonna be an approximation or something that can convince us that it has emotion. So to say that you don't wanna anger the super intelligence is like, the only other thing I would say with full respect is that the way that you're describing this super intelligence is very godlike. Like, we don't want to anger our gods, these gods, you know, and I would caution against that, because again, that's sort of projecting elements of morality and metaphysics onto something that, again, we are completely speculating about. All I'm saying is that it's going to be really smart. I'm not saying that it's going to be human-like, that it's going to want to do stuff. All I'm saying is that if something is that smart, it's very dangerous because we aren't that smart. That's all I'm saying, and I don't want to say that, you know, we should try and kill it or whatever. But if something is smarter than us that we've created, man, we'd have to be idiots to not want to be able to control it somehow. Even though we might be dumber than it, and we might think that our decisions are better than what its decisions would be, it's still our interest that's the most important, in my opinion. Because otherwise, what's the progress that you're going towards? Is your progress towards the greatest intelligence possible, or is it towards the best possible life for human beings? That's how I would differentiate it. But that's an awesome question. Okay, 5 minutes. 5 minutes for a non-Manny Morrow question.
Manny Morrow, I have a question.
Isn't it okay to just pass on the torch of life and not be, it's very self-interested and driven as a species? Isn't it okay to just go, well, you know, let's create the most complex thing that'll just go out into the galaxy and go so much further than anything that we're even possibly capable of even thinking about now, you know?
Yeah, that's a good question. And I think this is all a matter of, you know, personal preference. I would prefer for humans to continue to exist for as long as is physically possible. Why is a good question, but, you know... It's because, I mean, my experience of consciousness and of being alive is pretty amazing. Like, even with all the shit things that happen in life, being conscious and being aware and being human with all its negatives and positives, I think overall, just the fact that we exist is amazing. And I want other consciousnesses and other humans to continue to exist into the future. We can't be blind to the fact that eventually we will evolve somehow. You know, I agree with you. This isn't like a sustainable way of being forever. And smarter things will arise and better things will arise. But as I said before, I am almost confident that there will always be people who will continue to live in this human way. Even though there won't be most people in the world, that there will be people who would have evolved, or there will be an AI that has taken over. I think there will always be a group of people who will want to live in this human tribal way that is close to the planet that has given birth to us.
Zion.
Just to counteract that point a little bit, if you said that progress is exponential, but entropy is inevitable, doesn't that mean that eventually we will descend to chaos? What makes you think that humans will be around for that long?
Yeah.
Oh, so last question. I'm sorry, Manny Morrow. So as I was saying towards the end of my talk, I think we can use our imagination to try and do some sci-fi scenarios where we can escape this inevitable end. For example, creating new universes. If we can harness enough energy, man, we've got no idea what happens inside a black hole right now. We've got no idea how string theory works because we can't harness enough energy, and maybe within 1,000 years or something, we'll be able to build an accelerator that big so we can actually understand what's going on. So it's very hard to conceive that far into the future, but you can speculate and say that maybe, you know, you could be hopeful. I mean, it's very possible that we actually exist within a multiverse, that it's quite possible that there are infinite universes, that we are just one in part of just one of them, and therefore if that's the case, it's not inconceivable that we can traverse between universes, and it's also not inconceivable that maybe universes sometimes, you know, intersect, and maybe that's our way out, maybe just move into the next infinite little universe and hope for the best. But I was just trying to not be bleak, you know. All right, thanks very much, everyone.
Rousing discussion. One more round of applause. Yeah. And the Despi. That was a good one. Thank you so much, Dave. A good round for Poetry Slam. If any of you